I'm probably the only one here who comes from a different perspective and who is not really engaged in the profession of communications as such. But I have several years of experience working for the liberation movement in Eritrea. One correction, thank you for the nice words, but I interrupted actually my PhD studies at Harvard University to go to the bush and fight. And that represented a very drastic disruption in my life. I left the comfort of Harvard in Cambridge and went to the bush with all kinds of deprivations and risks. Because when we talk about war, of course, I like to underscore the fact that there are two kinds of war, at least in my view. There's a just war, a war that's waged in self-defense, a war that's waged for freedom, for liberation, to secure one's rights as a person, as a people, as a community. That kind of war, to me, is just and worth fighting for. There's another kind of war that I would not fight, and that's a war of aggression, a war to dominate, a war to maintain a status quo that's unfair to the vast majority of the people. And that kind of war, to me, is an unjust war. So when I joined the Eritrean War of National Liberation, I was deeply convinced that it was a just war. And of course, wars represent great disruptions. Wars in revolution, wars destroy lives, communities, disrupt nations. And revolutions turn things upside down. But when the war ends, a new order takes place, and then the ones which were the champions of change develop a vested interest in the new order and become defenders of the status quo. So what one sees in the life of nations, peoples, communities, is that a disruptive process, or life is actually a series of events, alternates of disruption, stabilization, setting of domination, and the system which strove for change through conflict, through war, through armed struggle, sort of atrophies, and then sets in motion a new dynamic that strives to overturn that. And I will explain this in the specific setting of Eritrea. And of course, I'm not sure how many of you know about Eritrea. The first thing that comes to mind is, what is Eritrea anyway? So I'll put the, this is, yeah. And of course, I'm talking about war. In war, people talk about collateral damage, unintended consequences, etc. But this collateral damage, so-called in the media, involves lives. And wars, as I said, destroy, kill. Actually, war is a legalized system of mass destruction and mass murder. However justified, was a war of aggression or a war of liberation, the results, the consequences on the civilian population, on the most vulnerable sectors of society, are the same. You find killings, you find lost opportunities, children, instead of going to school in a normal society, end up in refugee camps, displaced, very often hungry, unsheltered, etc. So this is Eritrea, the Red Sea, this is the Indian Ocean, the Gulf of Aden. So Eritrea has a very strategic position in a very volatile region. Now, I'm sure many of you have heard of militant Islamist insurgency in Somalia, perhaps, also of maritime piracy in the Red Sea, the Western Indian Ocean. And of course, there is a formidable international naval armada, which includes a very significant European contingent trying to face the menace of piracy, to prevent it, and to ensure international shipping, because this is a very strategic area. If you move up north, you find the Suez Canal, which links the Red Sea to the Mediterranean, and of course, the Middle East to Europe, and onwards to America. And here, of course, the Bab of El Mandeb between Yemen, Eritrea, and Djibouti on the African side, which, of course, through which passes most of the oil in the region. So this is a very volatile, oil-rich, strategic region, and Eritrea occupies a very pivotal position. And it's because of that, perhaps, Eritrea has, for the last, let's say, a couple of hundred years, been a battleground of various forces, regional, international forces, and the war was fought, in fact, to undo what the great powers did post-World War II in the post-war settlement, because Eritrea, along with Somalia and for a brief period, Ethiopia, were Italian colonies. And after the defeat of the Axis powers, the British, the Allied, they occupied them as occupied enemy territories. Afterwards, of course, in the disposal, Eritrea was singled out for denial of the right self-determination. And that's why we had, it was federated with Ethiopia, and then Ethiopia abrogated the federation, et cetera, et cetera. I don't want to go into great detail on this, but just to put the conversation this morning in context. So what did we do in the war? Of course, the war was multifaceted. It had political, economic, social, cultural aspects. But communication provided the link that wove all these aspects together. And we tried to convey a very positive message, message of hope and optimism. We're fighting for the rights of determination. And the rights of determination, the struggle for freedom, we characterized, we branded it as just and legitimate. And then we also said that the aspirations for freedom, the aspirations for equality, for the aspirations for prosperity, these are universal aspirations. These are fair and shared by all people. So we're trying to appeal also to the innate humanity of mankind, as well as to the democratic impulse in people in order to generate support and solidarity for our cause. And also, of course, our internal work, propaganda work, you can call it, or information work, it focused on the justness of our struggle, on the legitimacy of our struggle, and of course, on the universality of our aspirations, and on the inevitability of our victory. And that's how we were able to win the hearts and minds of our people, and the commitment of our youth to fight, and of course, be willing to make the supreme sacrifice. For them, freedom became larger than life, and the struggle for freedom became more important than the search for the preservation of life. In other words, people were putting their lives on the line for a cause that they believed to be just. And that was really the secret of our victory and, of course, the outcome of our communication work. So now I'm going to briefly speak about the use of communication at three levels or at three different stages in my experience. First, during the war, as I implied earlier, we used communication as an instrument of liberation to mobilize our people, to mobilize international support for our cause, and international support and solidarity meant also resources of various kinds, but most of all, moral and political support that anchored our struggle as part of the struggle for freedom, struggle for democracy, and struggle for prosperity. And because of that message, we were able, of course, to gain significant support. So the first aspect is I'm going to speak, I've already touched on the use of communication as an instrument of liberation. It was a very difficult struggle, and many observers at the time likened it to a struggle or to a contest between Goliath and David. That's the biblical analogy. Because Ethiopia was much larger, stronger, population, resource-wise, area-wise. Eritrea may be about one-tenth of the country. But our effective use of communication to mobilize the people and to mobilize international public opinion helped us overcome the conventional calculus that numbers, especially in battlefield, numbers and weapons make a difference. In our case, our experience shows that Numbers, yes, they are important. Weapons, yes, they are important, but they are not decisive. It's the people who are convinced of the justness of their cause, who are willing to fight to the end for victory that matter, and our communication work, I think, underscored that. So we won the war, and the end of the war, the Imperial Ethiopian State, maybe I don't know how many of you know about Ethiopia, a very large country which has a long history, it was disrupted and it was also divided. So a new arrangement was the outcome of the war. When we won the war, that war led not only to the independence and statehood of Eritrea, but also to the disruption of Ethiopia as it was historically known, to the emergence of a new configuration in Ethiopian politics. And at that time, there was a lot of euphoria. People were celebrating, etc. And there was much hope. And maybe I will come to this theme again. This is, of course, the effect of our ability to mobilize people. People flocked from all kinds, from the countryside, from the cities, from universities in Europe, in America, like myself, to go and fight for freedom. And this is, of course, the images are very bad, unfortunately, because they were taken from YouTube. But this is our second Congress, and I bring this because it was a very important stage in our struggle. Initially, in the first few years, I mean, this is a struggle that went on from 1961 until 1991. And I played an active role. I was actively engaged in that struggle for 19 of the 30 years. And so we're able to mobilize our people, and we're able to organize. And in our second Congress, we changed, we rebranded our front, the Eritrean People's Liberation Front, from one which was wedded, many of you from maybe from Eastern Europe can connect with me. We were advocating an ideology that we refer to as scientific socialism, in other words, hardcore Marxist-Leninist. In this second Congress, which took place in 1987, we came up with a modification which rebranded our movement more of as a social democratic movement committed to a mixed economy where the private sector would be the dominant, would play the dominant role, but government would have also regulatory functions in the state. And I bring this, this is the second Congress, that's of course me, I was in the secretariat managing the Congress. And this is Abdurrahman Babu, many of you may not know, but he's one of the pioneer Pan-Africanists. He was Zanzibari, he was a minister in the Nyerere government many times, he fell out, etc. But when he came and visited Eritrea 2 years before this Congress, he saw, because in Africa we have all kinds of disappointments, the post-colonial state was not able to deliver democratic governance, was not able to deliver sustainable development, was unable to deliver also prosperity for the vast majority of the people. And there was a big disappointment among Pan-Africanist leaders, including Babu. But in 1985, when he visited Eritrea, spent 2 weeks with us, he said, "I saw the future of Africa, and it works." He was very hopeful that Eritrea would be different, would learn from Africa's experience and avoid the failures and disappointments that were characterized with the post-colonial or typical post-colonial African state. And then, of course, that's Abdurrahman Babu, and that's, of course, maybe Yoshi Eid, a member of the German Greens. I picked on these two, but we had very many people, very celebrated personalities from the international community who came to express their solidarity and support for us in the second Congress. And that was the result of the effective communication we undertook, our information work portraying a message of hope and optimism, a message of democracy, of freedom, of future prosperity, etc., which attracted a lot of support for us internationally as well. But after the liberation, things began to change. As I said earlier, the former victims become now the victors, and they start to develop a stake in the status quo. And maybe I will perhaps make an analogy here, which may be a little oversimplistic, but I think it will make the point. One can liken the president of a country, the chief executive officer of a company. And what happens when the chief executive officer shuts down communication, insulates himself or herself, surrounds herself or himself with people who tell him stories that he or she likes to listen or to hear? He effectively isolates oneself. He shuns diversity. He develops distrust for people who tell him or her things the way they are, etc. And that begins to alienate people, and the best people begin to leave or to perform less. Profitability declines, performance declines, and eventually this might lead to things falling apart, if not to total bankruptcy. I think this analogy applies. After independence, what we have seen is an attempt to control the communication in the country, to constrain the conversation in the country, to constrain dialogue in the country. How? The state took control of the media, so totally state-controlled. State control was used to facilitate the control of the message, the flow of information. And through that, any divergent of opinion was banished. Any dissent was criminalized. And so you have a total closure of the political, economic, and social space, bringing, of course, greater alienation of the people. And, of course, people living, like myself, indicated that I had different positions. Yes, I was president of the university, governor of the central bank, and commissioner for the peace process between Eritrea and Ethiopia during the Second War, etc. But in all these positions, I was actually fired because I stood up for what I believed to be right. I preferred to leave, to be at peace with my own conscience than to obey what I thought would be, at the time, what I thought and I still think are wrong orders with negative impact or consequences for my work and for my country. So as Philip, I think, earlier stated, conflict is a normal aspect of life. Conflicts, disputes, even in a family, even husband and wife, we always argue. There's nothing wrong with that. It's how we handle that that matters. So we must really embrace dialogue. We must embrace diversity of opinion. And we try to build consensus through dialogue, through discussion, the ability to listen, the ability to tolerate ideas that are different from one's, even hostile to one's own, I think is a fundamental aspect of the democratic process. And it applies to the family, I think, to the company, to the country, to society at large. And so after the liberation, we have this the use of communication as an instrument of control, alienation. This is a group of young Eritreans who fled the country, actually. According to UN statistics, what we have is around 3,000 young Eritrean men and women leaving the country across the Sudan, across Ethiopia, for refugee to become refugees elsewhere at great risk their lives. Many of them lose their lives in the... It's time? Okay. I'm sorry, I'll wrap up very quickly. Maybe I got carried away. Okay. So this is what happens. When you try to control communication, when you try to control the message, shut down conversation, you get alienation and people start to leave, like myself and the best people in industry, entrepreneurs, the professionals, etc., even government officials, top government officials, when they have an opportunity to go abroad, they abscond because they cannot stand the divergence between what we fought for as a people and what we've gotten today as a people also. And so now, just to wrap up, what I can say is, of course, the disruptive communication for disruptive times. And I like that because I think we need to to use communication as a mode of adaptation to change. And in order to do that, we have to leave channels of communication open, we have to embrace diversity, and we have to also engage in dialogue with a new message. And so what we need to do is use the power of communication, both the mass media and the social media, the web, etc., to create a new vision of freedom, of democracy, of prosperity, of hope. And also to enhance dialogue among ourselves or among the interested parties, the concerned parties. And of course, through that, what you can do is disrupt the structure of isolation, the structure of dictatorship that has been imposed, and build a new order of democracy, of prosperity, and of progress for everyone. With this, I thank you very much for your attention.